welcome to our DMACC Career Discovery event. We have some UnityPoint health professionals here with us today for the Ask a Professional segment. Our hope is that these events will link your education and your career interests to professionals right here in Central Iowa. So before I introduce our healthcare professionals for today, I would like to say hello. My name is Jill Hoik, and I'm accompanied by my colleague, Amy Stainhook, and we are both a part of the work-based learning team here at DMACC. So during this presentation, if you have any questions for our professionals today, feel free to unmute yourself and ask them the questions, or of course, you can always leave them in the chat too as well. So without further ado, I would love to introduce our healthcare professionals for today. Thank you guys so much for being on the call. We have Curtis Long. He is a respiratory therapist. And we also have Dena Vogel. She's a medical technologist. And Angie Clark is a child life specialist. And then Natalie and Jen are also on the call from UnityPoint Health Des Moines too. So with that, I will kind of open up the first question. But again, if any of you on the call have any for them, feel free. So I will start with Dena, just because she's the first on my screen here. Can you just introduce yourself and give us some background and why you chose your career path?
Okay, so my name is Dena Vogel, and medical technologist is someone who works in the lab running all your lab tests. And I originally chose this because I like math and science, but nursing, I didn't think nursing was going to be for me. So I'm still in healthcare. I still get a help, but I don't have that patient contact every day. I'm kind of a lab nerd. I like to just be in the lab doing my thing and helping out that way. There is two different pathways. You can have a 2-year degree and work in the lab, or a 4-year degree. And a four.
No, did we lose Dena?
Okay, well, we'll move on to Curtis. If you could just give us your background and maybe why you chose your career path as a respiratory therapist.
Sure. So yes, I'm Curtis Long, respiratory therapist, UnityPoint Health. So my background actually is kind of a strange one. I started out as a professional musician. I used to be a professional trombonist. I've worked in the corporate world. I've worked as an EMT. I've worked as a dialysis tech. Early in my about mid-20s, I was looking at getting involved in healthcare. Actually, back then, I was looking at going to school for medicine to be a doctor, but I was not done performing. So after a few more years playing, as a trombonist, you have to study out the respiratory system. Oddly enough, you have to study how to breathe, which seems kind of silly, but you know, when you're playing things like Wagner or Mahler, you have to be able to play these big, long, grandiose. So you have to learn about the respiratory system. Time as an EMT, very similar things to what you learn in your first year as a respiratory therapy student. I looked at being a nurse, but nurses, you know, God bless them, they're the backbones of our healthcare system, but they work in one area. I don't want to work in one area. I love my, as an RT, I move all over the hospital. I may be in the ER one minute, I may be up on a med surge floor the next in the CCU, I might be intubating somebody in a conscious sedation. I do all kinds of things. So this career made a lot more sense for me with my background and what I was interested in doing. So,
yes. So I am a child life specialist at Blank Children's Hospital here in Des Moines. And so part of our job is to try and make the experience for children in the hospital as positive as it can be. So our days vary each day. But my background, originally I wanted to be a nurse as well to kind of get in the medical field like my mom was. But I knew I wanted to work specifically with children. When I was at the University of Iowa, I did dance marathon and met up with a child life specialist, and it just kind of meshed my career goals being in the medical field and working with kids in the same field. So I obtained a degree in therapeutic recreation from Iowa, as well as a human development and family studies from Iowa State. And I've worked here for about 16 years and kind of worked all through the hospital. We work in the emergency rooms, in the surgery department, in our x-ray departments, in our clinics, in our inpatient world. So every day is different, which kind of gives you an interesting perspective on each day.
Awesome. And then would you go over, I know some of you have already kind of went over the type of education that you have in order to be in your profession, but could you just go over that one more time of what your education background is?
Just want one of us to jump in?
Yeah, go ahead, Curtis.
Okay. Well, RTs, it's a two-year program. There are actually two certifications, the certified respiratory therapist and the registered respiratory therapist. As far as clinical practice, there's really little difference what the certified and the registered can do. Going forward, however, the registered respiratory therapist will be the thing that most facilities are going to want. The difference is, one, you just have to take 150 multiple choice question, test question when you're done with your schooling. The other one, after that, you have to pass that test at a certain level and then go on to a clinical simulation test. So there's two exams RTs have to take to get your RRT. Both of them are extremely demanding. With schooling, what I'd highly recommend you do is if you were to decide to go into actually any of these programs, get all of your prerequisites out of the way first, your microbiology, your physiology, your anatomy. Don't go through your program trying to do that stuff because the programs are very demanding. I made the mistake of trying to do my fourth semester as an RRT program, my micro, and I barely passed that semester. So 2 years, focus in on it, dedicate yourself to it, have everything done before you go into it. That's what I would recommend.
Fantastic. Thanks, Curtis. Angie, how about you as the child life therapist? What was your educational background?
Yes. So child life specialists require a 4-year degree. And it can be in anything from child development to education to psychology, human development, all of those different things. You are also required to do a practicum during that 4-year time, which is 100 hours following a child life specialist at a hospital. And then at the end of your 4 years, you're required to do an internship, which is usually 600 hours. Also following a child life specialist in multiple areas and kind of getting to do the work as well. After you complete all of that work and graduate, you have to sit for a national certification exam given through the Association for the Child Life Professionals. So once you complete that, then you are certified as a child life specialist nationally. I got my background at the University of Iowa. I got my 4-year degree, and then I ended up getting my master's at Iowa State. A master's is not required at this point in time. They are looking at it for the future, but not at this time. And one of our former coworkers who used to work in our department also teaches a class at DMACC, which is in the spring semester, which is an intro to child life course, which kind of gives you a little bit of background on child life as well.
Fantastic, thank you. So the next question, could you describe your typical day at work? And I know you're gonna say there probably isn't a typical day, but walk us through a day or a week, some of the things that you both would be doing in your respective positions.
Okay, so for my job, a lot of it is helping, like I said, to make the experience positive for kids and families while they're here. So a lot of what my job would be, I work in the surgery areas and the x-ray department. So a lot of it is preparation for the tests and the surgeries that they're going to have. So we do have things like we have surgery masks, different flavors so that the kids can play with them, see them before they're used in the operating room. We kind of introduce them to that. We also have teaching dolls. This is one of our teaching dolls. we can practice starting IVs, pretend IVs on those, different things that are going to happen to them. We can practice on our dolls so that they're able to feel the materials, use the materials before it happens to them, ask questions, kind of get familiar. If kids are prepared, they often are better to cooperate during procedures and things like that if they know what's going to happen to them, as well as parents knowing what's going to happen with their child while they're here. The second part of our job is distraction during some of those procedures. So we have lots of things like I Spy books, spinny lights that we use with the kids, stress balls if they need to squeeze something during an IV start, during a blood draw, during any of those things that happen, we can help distract them. A big part too is making sure that if kids have to spend a long periods of time in the hospital, that we're helping them to develop as they would outside of the hospital. So providing lots of play opportunities. We have playrooms throughout the hospital. They have been closed due to COVID, but we've been doing more one-on-one play in their rooms. And hopefully those will open back up soon. Also helping other therapists and things like physical therapy. If the kids need to get up and walk or do something like that, we can make a scavenger hunt around the floor so they can go look for things, and it encourages them to walk in a more fun way, as well as if they need to do breathing and they need to take deep breaths, it helps to maybe have something to focus on, like a pinwheel, something like that, that they can blow on. To kind of help them get through those things that they need to get through. So that's a big part of our job, what we do daily, is just a lot of support for children and families while they're here.
Mm-hmm. Angie, I see so much creativity having to happen in your position. And also the need to be able to work with so many different other professionals. I mean, you mentioned, you know, working with doctors and nurses and respiratory therapists and physical therapists. So
Yes,
certainly a big variety, it sounds like, in your day.
You most definitely do, yes. And you learn a lot about the different professions and how to work with them really well. So yeah, we're just a part of the team here. So it's a big team and we're just glad to be part of it.
Sure. Curtis, how about you? Could you walk us through a day or a week, some of the things you might work on?
Well, as you said, a typical day, there is no such thing as a typical day, but in general, you can expect to work three 12-hour shifts in a week. That's what most of places do. A typical day starts around 6:30 in the morning or 6:30 in the evening. You'll get your report from the off-going shift. And then around 7 o'clock, you'll start your day. Now that's assuming that between 6:30 and 7, you didn't get called for a code or you didn't have to run down to the ER or the unit for something. So the first 4 hours of your day are generally the most intense. That's when you generally have the most treatments to do. We do the nebulizer treatments, any chest physiotherapy, coordinating with nurses and doctors as far as what do we think a patient might need. So we'll go and we'll assess a patient. We'll say, well, we think that this patient needs, say a nebulizer and some sort of bronchial hygiene clearance device. So chest physiotherapy. You know, we have a list of things that we have to do that we print those off before each shift. So that's our to-do list. But in between that, we could be called. For instance, I work primarily at Lutheran, and Lutheran generally has two therapists. One takes care of the critical care unit, one takes care of the ER, and then they share the floors. So in between my to-do list, I could be called down to the ER to intubate somebody, to help a doctor to give a nebulizer treatment, to set somebody up on some sort of a device, but I still have my to-do list. So those first 4 hours are the most heavy. Get through those first 4 hours and then you can start, you still have things you have to do. During the day shift, there's a lot of extra things. OR will call you, pre-op and post-op might call you. It's like I said, there's really no standard day as far as what you get. You could have a day where you get everything done and you go back to the report room and have a nice cup of coffee, and then you have the next day where you don't see the report room for 12 hours. But so if I were to break it down, first four are the most intense, and then the second four a little bit less, and then the third four, if you're lucky, you actually have a little bit of time to plan for the oncoming shift. So It'll definitely keep you busy though, depending upon which hospital you use work at. Methodist for us is a much more intense experience than Lutheran, though Lutheran can keep you quite active, so.
Sure. Thanks, Curtis. I enjoyed hearing a little peek into your world a little bit. I asked the students on the line what types of careers they were thinking about. Someone responded nurse to potentially a doctor, nurse practitioner, respiratory therapist or occupational therapist. So as they're thinking of careers in healthcare, what do you feel are some of the most important skills or personality traits that healthcare providers exhibit? What comes to your mind?
I think flexibility to mind for sure. You have to be very flexible just because, like Curtis was saying, there's no typical day. You may go into the day thinking this is how it's going to go and it goes completely the other way. So you have to be very flexible and you have to have good time management. Because you see a lot of patients during the day and you have to know how to manage that time to be able to see as many as you can and give quality care.
Yep. And yeah, flexibility, I definitely agree with that wholeheartedly. And on top of that, you have to be patient. You have to be willing to work as a part of a team. You can't be a person that's so focused in your own little world that you can't see what other people are doing. You have to be willing to listen. Like I said, you know, we coordinate with other departments. A lot of times if I go into a patient's room, I need to hear what the nurse or the doctor is telling me so I can help them. You know, the entire thing is we're trying to help each other. There's no one person that fixes that patient. The entire team does. So you have to be willing to work with each other, listen to each other, be patient, realize nobody is perfect. Everybody makes mistakes. There's no perfect answer. That's the biggest thing right there.
Yeah, I would think teamwork would be absolutely necessary. You know, if you're someone that likes to just kind of work by yourself, probably not going to happen much in healthcare. So thank you for that. Students, I do want to hear from you. So if you have questions, we want to make sure that we are answering the questions that you have. So please, oh, we have one. Piper, thank you. Are there very many days where it is quiet or less busy? Or does that mainly depend on what position you work in? Do you see ebbs and flows in your schedule?
Oh, yes, definitely. Sorry, I wasn't trying to step on you there. definitely. You know, we'll have days where we get through our treatment. So we said start at 7 and by 8:30 I'm done. And I'm preparing for the next 4. And then there are days where I said, I won't see the department. I had one time, it's a great example. I was working on blank. It was in 2019. It was probably the worst season we'd had in blank. We actually had ventilators down in the ER, which we didn't keep ventilators in the ER. I had to force myself to take 15 to 20 minutes to leave blank, go back to our department and eat something, and then go back to blank. And those 20 minutes were the only 20 minutes I spent in the department other than that. And so you'll have times where you simply don't sit down, and then you'll have days where, yeah, you can kick back and have a cup of coffee and see how people are doing. It just depends.
Angie, how about you?
Yes, so I agree. Our areas kind of ebb and flow too, especially when COVID started last year. I work in the surgery department and all elective surgeries were called off. So we went down from seeing, you know, 150 kids maybe the previous month to maybe 10. But we work in so many areas so I work in the surgery radiology area, but I can also help in other areas. So we have, like I said, we have people in the emergency room, the clinics, surgery, radiology, all of our inpatient floors as well. So I can go help with that. We also get called to the adult side of the hospital to help explain to children of adults what is happening while their loved one is in the hospital. Even though it ebbs and flows, there are days that are definitely a little bit slower than others. We still have lots of areas that we can go to. So,
Another question we had in the chat, and I was going to ask this if it didn't come up. Obviously, there's a lot of, I'm sure, wins and good times in healthcare, but there's also a lot of difficult times. So the question from the chat was, what's the hardest part of your job working with kids? And maybe also to tag on to that, Curtis and Angie, how do you handle the difficult times in healthcare? I mean, how do you personally separate that so that you don't get so bogged down perhaps with some of the really challenging cases or patients or situations?
Yes. So part of our job is actually to help with the bereavement process. When a child dies, we actually help make memories, memory boxes, memory hand molds for the families. So we are a part of that. We help children understand what the word death means in different ways. So that's the hardest part of our job, especially working with these families. You can work with kids in the clinics for years and years and years and get to know their families very, very well. Or it can be a very tragic instant situation that is just, you know, really tugs at your heartstrings. And so that's the hardest part of our job, I think, is that bereavement process. We have an amazing team here. Our child life team is great to debrief with, to talk with. We have groups within the hospital that also help you to debrief during those different situations and have the groups of people come together to kind of talk about that. But I've learned over the years that you do have to separate your work life from your home life, and you kind of have to leave it here. So when you get home, you have to focus on other things. You have to have hobbies to do, spending time with your family, taking a walk. You know, sometimes I have an hour drive home, so that usually gives me time to kind of process my thoughts and kind of do that by myself before I get home. So you just kind of have to carve out ways in which help you the best and rely on your team members that are here, because they've also kind of been part of that process and they're great ones to debrief with.
Yeah, like Angie said, your team members, that's going to be a big one. Hopefully you have a good team. That's going to be your go-to quite often. Hopefully you have good management and they will help get you if you need to talk to somebody. As far as dealing with the wins and the losses, you know, you will have times where you'll be sitting there for us as clinicians out on the floor in with the patients. I've seen nurses in there as a patient is passing on and they just sit with the patient. They'll just hold their hand. They'll be there, especially with COVID, with family has not been able to be there. They've been in there. I've been in patient rooms and just sat there and held their hands and talked to them. We all have, you know, everybody in healthcare, everybody who's been in a patient room has done this at some point in time. That's very difficult. They'll look at you and they'll ask you the question, you know, am I going to live? And well, yeah, I mean, you don't lie, but how do you answer a question like that? So, you know, if you're lucky, you have family members who can be there, talking, you know, just listening to family members, if they need to talk to you. The greatest wins we have nowadays, is, you know, well, with COVID, anybody who actually leaves the hospital who's been on a ventilator or any one of these heated high flow systems, that's the win. But, you know, nonetheless, it's hard. It can be very hard. I can say that I've watched a few medical shows where the doctors come out of the room and sat there and cried in the hallway. Well, it happens, but not like that. You know, generally speaking, you're so busy, you don't have time to do that, but you will at some point, it will hit you. And that's like, you know, Angie said, and I agree, you know, your team is very important there. Hopefully you have a good team you can rely upon in those times.
Great, thanks for sharing that. So then on the flip side, and you mentioned it a little bit, Curtis, but some of the most rewarding things about your job, can you speak to that?
I love to be able to work with the patients, work with the people. Being able to educate, especially as respiratory therapists, obviously we're focused on the respiratory system. So asthmatics and COPDers, being able to educate them and help them and hopefully give them some information that can keep them out of the hospital. I kind of jokingly say that, the hospital is the one place where I can look at you and say to you in the nicest, kindest, most loving way possible, I hope I never see you here again. We want to work ourselves out of a job, which seems kind of counterintuitive in business, but that's the case. So to be able to work with a patient and actually help them to understand their medications, how to utilize those medications, what they're for, and not see them again, and or maybe see them again and say, hey, you made a big difference. That's a great win right there. So.
Yeah, I think the same as what Curtis was saying too with kids. It's amazing to see them come in, like some kids are under the chairs crying because they're so nervous about what's going to happen to them here. And if we can talk with them, show them, prepare them, give them the skills to get through what they need to get through, they walk out of here so proud that they were able to accomplish that. And that helps them to get through for, future experiences when they aren't here too. So I think that's the biggest win for us, is just to see kids realize that they can get through these, that they do have those skills, and they just look so proud when they leave.
Angie, I think there need to be adult specialists too, that when I need to get sticked with a needle, that you can bring your special lights and your pinwheel and things.
Thinking the same thing, Amy. I was about to say, Angie, do they have an adult life? Because my husband will need one if he ever has to come into the hospital for anything. Not kidding.
So maybe between DMACC and UnityPoint, we can create that new certificate program or something, right?
Perfect.
Okay, two more questions. One, I want to make sure Ellie's question gets answered, and I don't want to end on a depressing note. So I'll ask one after that. Okay. So Ellie, just wanted to circle back to what you mentioned, Curtis. How do you answer that question when a patient asks you if they're going to pass?
I saw that pop up. Oh Lord. Oh God. Ellie, I don't have an answer for you. Just use your gut. I guess one particular situation I just told him, he asked me, am I going to die? And I said, well, honestly, it just doesn't look good. Because are you going to die? Well, you're still breathing. You're still here with us. There's always, as long as you're breathing, there's still a chance. Now, I've read some things by paramedics out there in the field where they, and after a while, you kind of get a feel for a patient that, yeah, you're not in a good position. And this one paramedic said, tell them the truth. Tell them the truth kindly. Don't say, yeah, you're going to kick the bucket. Don't say that. But, if they ask you, you're going to die, yeah, you're probably going to die. But how do you say it? How do you let them know? I don't think it's, should you let them know? How do you let them know? If a person's going to die, they want to know. But I honestly don't have an answer. That's something you'll have to figure out should you experience that.
Mm-hmm. So. Kind of comes back to, I'm sure I'm just assuming all healthcare practitioners learn those skills. They learn that bedside manner. They and probably learn from your colleagues and dialogue around some of that at times, I'm assuming. But I'm sure that is part of the job. It's being that compassionate care, right? So Ellie, good question. Okay, so we are at our time, but I want to end with this one. Curtis and Angie and Jen too, what advice would you have for these young people, high school students that are considering a career in the healthcare profession? What advice would you give them as they journey on and figure out their path?
I think reach out to professionals and talk to them about their jobs, ask them questions, especially, if anyone's interested in child life, there's a great website, the Association of Child Life Professionals, and that kind of lays it out for you, what the educational requirements are, what the job actually is. So I would do just more research and definitely reach out to people, because people are happy to talk about their profession and kind of give advice too.
In addition to that, I'd say get yourself into a job that gets you patient experience. So a CNA, EMT, dialysis tech. These are all entry-level jobs that don't require a lot of education. Generally, they're about a three or four month course, and they'll get you involved in healthcare. You can see what happens. You can actually experience it. I think the big thing for people going into healthcare, they have this idea of what's on TV. Well, that's not healthcare. Doctors don't get 3 days to deal with one patient. You know, they get 1 day to deal with 80 patients, you know. So get into healthcare, see what actually happens. And that'll be a great way for you to actually see, is this something I want to go into? And if yes, well, what field? Because you'll be able to see a lot of different departments and a lot of different areas working in the hospital.
Yeah, and remember what Natalie said in the previous portion of this about the food service area, the food host. I mean, you are on those floors, you are meeting patients, you are creating relationships with the team members up there. You'd see Curtis if he was on that floor. So, and Ange, if she was on that floor. And I circle back to what Angie said. There are a lot of people in your life that are probably in healthcare and you may not know exactly what they do, but asking questions and tell me about a day, you know, what a typical day is, kind of just exactly like what they talked about this morning.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. That's all great advice. I agree with all of it. And I want to give kudos to the students that have joined us this morning, because doing this is exactly what you need to continue to do. So any opportunities that allow you to engage with professionals who are in healthcare, it's only going to help you. So Angie, we did have, Sydney wanted to know, can you please repeat the website for Child Life? And Jill, could you type that in the chat when she mentioned it?
Go to www.childlifeallonword.org. That will take you to the site.
Perfect. Students, are there any last questions? We'd love to answer them, but also want to be aware of time here. I did mention in the chat that, you know, to Curtis's point, any of you are interested in taking a CNA course, many, many, many of our high school partners offer those courses either in your high school through concurrent enrollment or through the health science academies that DMACC offers. So if that's something that you're interested in, I think that is a fantastic way to get your foot in the door. Regardless of your long-term goals, you know, it's a great way, just a great part-time job and a great way to network and to figure out if patient care is for you. So if you want more information on that, make sure you reach out to myself or Jill at DMACC, and we can help put you in touch with the correct person. So last call here, any questions? Well, I appreciate the questions that you all did ask. Curtis and Angie and Jen, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate your willingness to join us today and all the information you provided us. So with that, we will sign off, and everyone have a fantastic day.
Thank you.